Let's practice U-substitution in definite integrals. Okay, so here we have the integral from negative 1 to 5 of sine of pi x dx. And we know a formula for the antiderivative of sine ax, but let's use U-substitution just for the practice. So sine of pi x, to solve that, I would let u equal pi x. So then du would equal pi dx, which is the same as 1 over pi du equals dx. So that takes care of everything inside my integral as far as making substitutions. But what about the bounds on my integral? So right now, my bounds are x values. Okay, so I need to be careful with that. And there's two ways that people do this. So there's two ways to approach this. The first way is to just ignore the bounds altogether at the beginning. So I'm just going to, if you were doing this, you would just pretend that this was an indefinite integral. Right? You'd work through it, you'd find the antiderivative, you'd switch back to x's, and then you'd evaluate at the bounds using your original x values here, negative 1 to 5. So that's one way to do it. The other way to do it is to change these bounds to u values from the very beginning. And that's the way I'm going to do. So what I mean by that is I'm going to transform these. So x equals negative 1, if I plug it into u equals pi x, I get u equals negative pi. So that's my new lower bound. And then I can do the same thing with the upper bound 5, and I get u equals 5 pi, that's my new upper bound. So then we can entirely rewrite the integral. So the bounds now are negative pi to 5 pi. Okay, then what about the inside? Well, I have sine of u, and then dx is 1 over pi du. So I'm going to go ahead and put that 1 over pi out front. Okay, so I know that the antiderivative of sine is negative cosine. So this becomes negative 1 over pi cosine of u from negative pi to 5 pi. Now I just need to plug in my bounds. I can keep this negative 1 over pi out front. And then I'm going to have cosine of 5 pi minus cosine of negative pi. So here we have to remember a little trig. So the cosine of 0 is 1, and the cosine of pi is negative 1. And then any multiples of integer multiples of pi are going to be negative 1 as well. So cosine of 5 pi is negative 1. And then cosine of negative pi is negative 1 as well. So that's minus negative 1. So 1 minus negative 1 is 0. So then my final answer is 0 overall for this problem. Example 2 is the definite integral from pi over 6 to pi over 3 of secant x tangent x over secant of x plus 5. Okay, so what kind of substitution might we do here? Well, remember that the derivative of secant is secant x tangent x. So maybe we want to let u equal the denominator, secant x plus 5, and then du would just be secant x tan x dx. So this should be a dx here. So that takes care of everything inside the integral. Let's go ahead and transform the bounds as well. So we have x equals pi over 6, and I'm going to plug that into my expression for u. Okay, so u then would be secant of pi over 6 plus 5. So remember that secant is 1 over the cosine, okay, so it's the reciprocal of the cosine. So cosine of pi over 6 is root 3 over 2, so secant of pi over 6 then is 2 over root 3 plus 5. And then same thing for pi over 3. We want to transform that to a u value, so u equals secant pi over 3 plus 5. Okay, so cosine of pi over 3 is 1 half, and that the reciprocal of 1 half is 2. So this then is 2 plus 5, which is 7. So then if I rewrite my integral, it becomes the integral from 2 over root 3 plus 5 to 7 of, well, secant x tan x dx is all du. And then I've just got a u in the denominator. So this is just 1 over u du. Well, the antiderivative of that is the natural log of the absolute value of u. And I'm evaluating it from 2 over root 3 plus 5 to 7. So then this is the natural log of 7 minus the natural log of 2 over root 3 plus 5. So notice I dropped the absolute value signs. That's just because these values are already positive. Now, I could actually, because of the properties of logs, make this a division within the natural log. So natural log of 7 over 2 over root 3 plus 5. And you can even make that look a little nicer if you wanted to. But for our purposes, I'm going to stop here. Example 3 is the definite integral from 0 to 1 of e to the 5x times cosine squared of e to the 5x dx. So let's go ahead and make a substitution to solve this problem. It looks like I'm probably going to want to let u equal e to the 5x since that's what's inside this cosine squared. So let's see how it works out if I do that. So if I let u equal e to the 5x, the du, the derivative, is going to be 5e to the 5x dx. And that's good because I do have this other e to the 5x sitting out front. Okay, so this will take care of that. And I want to write it as 1 over 5 du equals e to the 5x dx. So that takes care of all the terms inside my integral. But let's go ahead and transform the bounds as well. So I have x equals 0. If I plug that into u, I get e to the 0, which is 1. Okay, so u equals 1. And then x equals 1 is my upper bound. If I plug that in, I get u equals e to the 5th. So then my integral becomes the integral from 1 to e to the 5th. I am letting... So this e to the 5x dx is 1/5 du, right? So I'm going to go ahead and put that 1/5 out front. And then we'll have our du. And then I'm going to have cosine squared of u. Okay, so this is my new integral, and everything's in terms of u. But if I look at this integral, now I'm going to have to do something else, some sort of extra work to solve this one, right? Because I don't know an explicit formula for cosine squared. But maybe you've seen before in a previous example a problem like this. And what you want to do here is use a trig identity. So I'm simply going to use a trig identity to rewrite cosine squared of u, and that trig identity tells me that equals 1 plus cosine 2u over 2. Okay? Now, I see that I have a factor of 1 half, so I could pull that out front and have 1 fifth and 1 half out front. And then a 1 plus cosine 2u inside. Well, now I need to integrate 1 plus cosine 2u. So on that 2u part, the cosine 2u, I'm going to make a substitution. So I'm going to let v equal 2u. Okay, so then dv would be 2du, or 1 half dv equals du. And then we need to transform the bounds. Okay, so u equals 1. It's going to give me v equals 2, right, because v equals 2 times u. And then u equals e to the 5th is just going to give me v equals 2e to the 5th. So then my new integral is 1/10 integral from 2 to 2e to the 5th. Let's see, I have 1 plus cosine of v times du, which is 1/2 dv. Okay, so I get an additional factor of 1/2 out front. That makes that 1/20th. Integral from 2 to 2 e to the 5th, 1 plus cosine v dv. All right, so now I can take the antiderivative of that. The antiderivative of 1 is v, and then the antiderivative of cosine is sine, so we have v plus sine v, and I'm going from 2 to 2 e to the 5th, and those bounds are already in terms of v, so all I have to do is plug in. Okay, so 1/20th out front, and then inside, let's see, I've got 2 e to the 5th plus sine of 2 e to the 5th minus the quantity 2 plus sine 2. Okay, and you could maybe simplify that just a tiny bit or find a decimal approximation, but this is our final answer for this problem. In example 4, we have the definite integral from 2 to 3 of x squared over 1 plus x to the 6th dx. Now, just glancing at this, it seems like maybe we're going to have to be a little tricky, right? Because I don't see anything obvious where I have, you know, something in its derivative. But, I mean, we could try letting u equal 1 plus x to the 6th and see what happens. But, of course, you quickly see that you just get 6x to the 5th dx, which I have an x squared, but that's a whole three other factors of x that I don't have, and I can't just introduce those x's. So that's not going to work. Okay, so this is where knowing your antiderivatives really well comes in handy, right? Because you might be able to recognize this form or a way you can rewrite this. Okay, so on the bottom here, I'm going to write this as 1 plus x cubed quantity squared. Okay, so why would I do that? Well, bear with me and we'll see that this works out. So if you let u now equal x cubed, then du would equal 3x squared dx. And all this is looking better because I have an x squared right on top. So I could write this as 1/3 du equals x squared dx. But why is that helpful, right? I have this 1 plus x cubed squared. That just looks kind of weird. Well, that's actually the form for the arctangent. Okay, so if you recall, if you have the integral of 1 over a squared plus x squared, that equals 1 over a arctan or inverse tan of x over a plus c. And that's basically what I have here. Instead of x squared, though, I have x cubed squared, but I'm making the substitution. Okay? So since we're going to make the substitution, let's go ahead and do the bounds as well, right? So I have x equals 2. If I plug that into x cubed, that's going to give me u equals 8. And then I've got x equals 3. If I plug that in, that's going to give me u equals 27. So my new bounds are from 8 to 27. And then what I have is, well, I've got 1 over 1 plus u squared. And then x squared dx is 1/3 du. So I can go ahead and put that 1/3 out front. And now you can see probably that arctangent form a lot more clearly. So then if I actually take the antiderivative, this becomes 1/3 inverse tan of u from 8 to 27. All right, and then I just plug in. So this is 1/3 inverse tan of 27 minus 1/3 inverse tan of 8. And that's my answer.